Mr. President, brothers and sisters, good afternoon to all of you. I welcome all of you present here and all of you who are connected to Adyar by the internet to this very first public lecture of our 139th International Convention. It's indeed a great pleasure for me to welcome Mrs. Linda Oliveira and invite her to speak to us this afternoon. She always speaks something new, something interesting, and something that lingers on long after she has stopped. She needs no introduction to all of us in Adyar. She has visited Adyar many times and spoken at many previous conventions. She has also worked here as the International Vice President with great humility and quiet dignity, which I wish I can emulate to some extent. She has held various positions in the Australian section of the Theosophical Society and is currently its National President. She has been a member of the TS since 1971. She joined the Society after hearing J. Krishnamurti's talks. Her arts degree at the Australian National University focused on humanities and political science. She has given lectures and conducted study camps in Australasia, the Indo-Pacific area, India, several European countries, and several countries in the Americas. Since 1990, she has been the editor of Theosophy in Australia magazine, which is a favorite of mine, including its editorials, and has coordinated the annual School of Theosophy in Australia since 2002, except when she was in Adyar. She has helped to organize two world congresses of the Theosophical Society. A primary inspiration in her life is Theosophy, especially the potential of Theosophy to profoundly transform an individual when it is reflected upon deeply and when it is practiced with heart and mind. In the fitness of things, she is now in charge of guiding more serious students of Theosophy. I now call upon Sister Linda to deliver her talk on the topic which has been chosen by her, the wheels of change transitioning from worldliness to sacredness. Yes.
Respected President and Vice President, brothers and sisters here and around the world. The topic of change is a fascinating one. While I was writing this talk, the national headquarters of the Theosophical Society in Australia were being packed up, or was being packed up, into many cardboard cartons because our headquarters was moving after nearly 30 years. There was much change in the air. So it seemed somehow a very fitting environment in which to contemplate the subject of change and experience the energy of change, which I'm sure all of us have done in many different ways. We're going to go back to 1878 for a moment. Some words about change were penned then by the poet Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. One of its verses reads, "Turn, turn my wheel. All things must change to something new, to something strange. Nothing that is can pause or stay. The moon will wax, the moon will wane. The mist and cloud will turn to rain, the rain to mist and cloud again. Tomorrow be today." Beautiful words, and such true words. All things must change to something new, to something strange. Nothing that we can experience with the physical senses in this world stays the same. We may wholeheartedly welcome the changing of the seasons, which we have known from childhood. Happily, the seasons are still fairly predictable in these days of climate change. Then again, we may be fascinated with the growth of small plants in our garden, or the growth of our children, or the growth of our grandchildren. We may take special delight in the almost imperceptible change in the quality of darkness as night gradually becomes day. Have you ever watched dawn? Have you ever sat and watched and waited and experienced that beautiful change as the sun eventually emerges? We are used to these kinds of change. They are comfortable. They are familiar types of change. A walk through the streets of Varanasi to the Ganga is indeed an experience. I was once staying at the national headquarters of the Indian section and left the headquarters at something like 4 o'clock in the morning. I started the journey while it was still dark, very dark. There was no activity, one could see very little, one needed a torch. Then it was as though there was a stage. One person came into view, then another person, and gradually experience opened up. There was change, there was movement, there were things happening, coming out of that darkness as the day started to emerge. More and more people came into focus until eventually there was a teeming crowd at the Ganga, at the holy river. It was an extraordinary experience, and there was vibrant colour and movement. So this is another kind of change when one sees certain things happening, the senses sees that things do not stay the same. To use Longfellow's words, something new emerges. In the wisdom tradition known today as Theosophy, one of the great propositions put forth regarding our universe is that of periodicity. In the magnum opus of Madame Blavatsky, The Secret Doctrine, there is talk of numberless universes, not just one or two, numberless universes, incessantly manifesting and disappearing. There's also reference to the appearance and the disappearance of worlds. Today, these numberless universes are designated by scientists as the multiverse or meta-universe, being the hypothetical set of possible universes. The appearance and disappearance of worlds, taught by Blavatsky, is a macrocosmic form of change, large-scale change, which is very, very different, difficult, really, for the mind to understand, for the mind to fathom. The proposition referred to also mentions the absolute universality of the law of periodicity, or, if you like, of flux and reflux, ebb and flow, right throughout nature. And we see this daily in all sorts of ways. Night follows day, periods of sleep are followed by waking periods, and so forth. Change is indeed one of the givens in life. Change is there whether we like it or not. Change occurs from moment to moment. Now let's think back to the line of Longfellow's poem again. All things must change, not only to something new, but to something strange. Now, some types of change are fairly predictable within certain broad parameters. But now we come to the harder aspect of change, which is less comfortable. Change into something which is not so predictable. Why is this harder? Because so many of us are simply afraid of the unknown. We are afraid of the unknown. We know that the moon will wax and wane. We know that mist and cloud will turn to rain, to use Longfellow's poetic terms. But the wisdom tradition suggests a different kind of change which is possible for the human being. This goes way beyond all the personal development courses which are available in many countries throughout the world today. It involves a radical transformation away from self-centered pursuits, away from wanting to grow the personal self, to the emergence of a new consciousness. This is the ultimate renewal of the human being, a consciousness which is immensely strange compared with the familiar me, which has existed since birth in this life. We don't really know what would happen to this me if we were to transform significantly. We can guess. We can read what the sages have said. But we do not know until experience actually comes about. And it is this fear of human change which is the focus of this presentation on transitioning from the worldly to the sacred. Therefore, what is the worldly? What is the sacred? And what does transitioning from the worldly to the sacred involve? We will consider these three questions with reference to thought from the East and thought from the West, and to writings which are both ancient and modern. So let's begin with the worldly. We are embedded in the worldly, that which is time-bound or earthly. Worldly means to be engrossed in temporal affairs, especially the pursuit of wealth and pleasure. It also means experienced in life, sophisticated, practical. The general feeling conveyed by these dictionary renderings is that worldliness consists of our engrossment in time-bound activities, and we are engrossed in these things most of the time, with all their pain and with all their pleasure. It consists of the so-called worldly wisdom, which derives from experience. It consists of a facade of ever-increasing sophistication and many other things besides. The worldly is the environment in which we live from day to day, with all of our hopes, all of our fears, all of our longings. It is also about our response to this environment, both collectively and as individuals. There are so many different ways of viewing the human world. One contemporary author called Hugh Mackay has written a number of books in the field of social analysis, social psychology, and ethics. He writes about what he calls the utopia complex, which is a very interesting term, the utopia complex. The word utopia comes from the title of Thomas More's 16th century book of the same name. Utopia refers to an imagined perfect place or perfect state of things. A perfect place or state of things. And Hugh Mackay asserts that to many people in the West, and I quote, "This feels like a golden age, and why not? Extraordinary advances in medical science, the explosion of information and communication technology that stimulates, informs, and entertains us like never before. Swift and cheap international travel, efficient, reliable, affordable cars, promising talk of a clean energy revolution, online shopping, and so forth." So to him, to many people in the West, this feels like a golden age. One could question, though, whether this utopia complex, that is, this sense that with materialism we have reached the perfect state, is limited to the West, given how rapidly similar changes are impacting many countries around the world. The author also remarks that it may be more difficult to have a continuing impression of a golden age if we were to peep into the world's refugee camps, the ravages of continuing wars, the eternal tensions of the Middle East, and so forth. He goes on to say this. He says, "We are busy establishing centres of excellence everywhere, and that we've been hooked on the idea of happiness as a natural entitlement. The whole phenomenon of Gen Y or Generation Y is an interesting one. One of the characteristics of this particular younger generation, at least as given where I come from in Australia, is a sense of entitlement, with an expectation that one should have everything now. Everything is there for the taking, as it were. According to this author, Hugh Mackay, self-esteem has been enshrined as a cardinal virtue, rather different from the virtues of ancient Greece. Self-esteem. And I suppose there is an extensive and perhaps overuse of Twitter and Facebook by some, and maybe this is part of it, self-esteem. Which is reflected in how one projects oneself to the world as well. Of course, Facebook is also very useful. I'm not suggesting that it is a bad thing necessarily. It's just how we use it. And utopians are conditioned, says Hugh Mackay, to assume that perfection in anything should be within their grasp. He says that many people have, in fact, adopted materialism as their driving philosophy. There are so many different varieties of philosophy and have been throughout history. But his suggestion is that materialism has become the driving philosophy of many people today. We're going to turn now, though, to Eastern philosophy. We read in that wonderful classic of Advaita Vedanta, the Viveka Chudamani, "In the forest land of objects wanders the great tiger named Manas." This is wonderful language. "In the forest land of objects wanders the great tiger named Manas," or we can think of it as mind. "Pure men, desirous of liberation, do not go there." The Manas, having clouded over the absolute consciousness, which is without attachment, acquires notions of I and mine, and through attachment to the body, organs and life, wanders ceaselessly in the enjoyment of the fruit of his actions. So this tiger, Manas or mind, wanders through this forest land of objects. And it's rather like that, isn't it? We have all these experiences in life. We are surrounded by objects. We kind of wander through them. And here is this tiger, the mind, which may revel in all of these things. And of course, a tiger is a wild animal too. And indeed, with the agency of our minds, we are wanderers through this world. There is a remarkably common obsession with the pursuit of all that the material world has to offer, driven, as the text says, by that great tiger, Manas, which refers to that vast field of thought and reasoning which is twinned with desire. The mind and the desire nature feed off each other so regularly. We desire something, the mind figures out some way of getting it. It's really quite extraordinary. And this pursuit of the material is very well exemplified in this little story too. The master once told of a neighbour in the countryside who had an obsession with acquiring land. And how many people like to acquire things? "I wish I had more land," he said one day. "But why?" asked the master. "Don't you have enough already?" "If I had more land, I could raise more cows." "And what would you do with them?" "Sell them and make money." "For what?" The answer was to buy more land and raise a lot of cows. So acquisitiveness is there. It seems to be part and parcel of living in this world. Not just acquiring things, not just acquiring physical possessions, but acquiring all sorts of ideas, opinions, prejudices, and so forth. Anyway, in addition to this acquisitiveness, Hume Mackay mentioned that materialism is sometimes married with religious or political faith. So somehow or other, this materialistic philosophy is worked in with religion, is worked in with political faith as well. And this can become the driving force for so many people in relation to how they live their lives. One could add that both of these are likely to be used by many people today, that is, religious or political faith, to support strongly materialistic lifestyles. Humakai describes the utopia complex as a neurosis, a disorder which is indissolubly linked to getting what we want. Brands had been more or less limited to corporations, but these days individuals are branding themselves all the time too, vying, competing for attention in that crowded marketplace which we also call society. And furthermore, narcissism has emerged again in the 21st century in a repackaged form as self-absorption along with a commonplace sense of entitlement. Now, one social analyst called Richard Eckersley talks about how we tend to fashion identity and meaning increasingly from personal achievements and possessions and less from shared cultural traditions and beliefs. So our sense of identity is quite often tied up in the personal, not in a communal kind of context. He observed that this distracts people from what is the most important to well-being, which is, in his view, the quality of their relationships, which ideally contribute to an enduring sense of intrinsic worth and existential certainty. In the meantime, though, this utopia complex, this neurosis, fills a certain vacuum. But the utopia complex eventually starts to run its course. And when this happens, the tremendous force of all that is worldly starts to loosen its grip a little bit. Something different is needed in order to fill this vacuum. So commences what may be initially a slow start in transitioning to a new way of living, in fact, eventually to a whole new life. Transitions are periods of change which are not so predictable. They're not entirely comfortable. We know the change is going on, but we don't really know what's going to happen next. There's a question mark there, and this can be quite profoundly uncomfortable at times. Now, this transitional process for the human being to a different way of living may start, and then stop, and then start again. To come back to Longfellow's words, we are starting to enter that something new, which is also something strange. Strange compared with how we are positioned now, with the enormous weight of worldly conditioning to contend with, which is reinforced hourly, which is reinforced daily by global media of all kinds. The human spiritual journey is fundamentally the same, regardless of differences in culture, differences in ethnicity, religion, and so forth. For we are all one race. We are all one race. It is just that we happen to look different from each other. We happen to speak differently from each other. We happen to come from different cultures. But we are one. And this journey, this human spiritual journey, invariably moves us from the worldly towards the universal, towards an otherworldly kind of wholeness, which has been described by sages throughout history in various ways. For those who are not aware, the Theosophical tradition includes the teaching of reincarnation for each individual to consider for themselves within the context of freedom of thought in this society. This teaching of reincarnation presupposes a series of many lives. It also presupposes a certain continuity between lives. If we assume that the soul evolves, then it seems very odd to imagine that we are given just one body, that we live just one physical life, and then simply cease to exist. The transition from worldliness to sacredness is hardly likely to begin with our governments. Other people may set examples and inspire us, but no one else can do this for us. We cannot appoint a proxy to help us consciously reconnect to our roots. There is mention in the Bhagavad Gita of the Ashvata tree. In one of the discourses, we read, "The Blessed Lord said, with roots above, branches below, the Ashvata is said to be indestructible. The leaves of it are hymns." Isn't that beautiful language? "The leaves of it are hymns. He who knoweth it is a Veda knower. Downwards and upwards spread the branches of it, nourished by the qualities, the objects of senses, its buds. And its roots grow downwards, the bonds of action in the world of men." The Ashvata tree is also described as the banyan tree of samsara, or worldly life. And of course we have some wonderful banyan trees here on this very property. We can see this principle at work. We can see these roots which move downwards towards the earth. So it's a very appropriate analogy. We cannot know the form of the Ashvata tree in this world. Its real roots may only be known through the unswerving weapon of non-attachment. Just to repeat that, its real roots may only be known through the unswerving weapon of non-attachment. For as long as this material world is our primary attachment, we have lost that north, that compass, which might otherwise help to bring us lasting stability. And which can help to really imbue us with the sacred. If we do not adopt an attitude of mindfulness, we become unthinkingly full participants in the utopia complex. In a similar vein, a Western scholar, Dr. David Tacey, who wrote a book called The Spirituality Revolution, mentions that what exhausts us, is our lack of connection to our invisible, life-sustaining roots. Describing today's society as addictive, he maintains that we are obsessed with playing it again, doing what we already know, doing whatever gives us sentimental comfort or nostalgia. It is easier to reproduce something than to make something new. It's a little bit like if we need to find a new place, we have to perhaps look at a map and learn the correct route to get from A to B. And at first it's difficult. But after a while, there is this kind of automatic tracking that takes place, and we can eventually do that walk without even thinking about it. And that's that playing it again, doing what we already know, doing what is easier to do, because we've done it many times before. So it is easier to reproduce something than to do something new, to make something new. Why is this? Because, well, it takes effort, doesn't it? It takes effort to do something new, maybe to experience something new. Going further, though, making ourselves into something new calls for a profound connection with what David Tacey called the deep roots of creativity. There is a creative energy in a certain kind of change. We are far more comfortable, as a rule, with the known, treading the familiar path of our routine lives. Humanity's grip on the known brings us back once again to Longfellow's Something Strange. This looms large when the nature of change is not so predictable. And it may also be regarded with trepidation because of this fear of the unknown. David Tacey writes, "The hope for the future is that we can overcome our obsession with imitations, stand-ins, substitutes and copies, and face the nature of the real, not just the surface real, but the deep real, from which," he says, "surprising, alarming, and transforming things emerge." This takes courage. Similarly, decades ago, one of the international presidents of the Theosophical Society, Dr. Annie Besant, referred in her writings to the turning point, which is the transition between the pravritti marga, or the path of outgoing, towards the nivritti marga, the path of return to our source. As with transitions generally, this can be a little painful. Why is this? Because on the one hand, we may gradually start to respond more sensitively to the one life in all around us, in every person, in every being that we encounter. Yet on the other hand, there's still this sense of wanting to act for personal gain, wanting to expand our personal self into the world. In short, there are contradictions between the new north, our new direction of the compass, on the one hand, and how we actually act in the world, on the other hand. Sages throughout history have demonstrated the very real beauty of humility, which is the subdual and transmutation of the sense of personal self in order to serve the sacred in all. False humility is quite common. Authentic humility does not seem to be so popular in the 21st century. In fact, it seems to be at times remarkably rare. The individual reigns supreme. And this is obvious in so many different types of self-branding. The way in which people do tend to push themselves forward, because this sense of a personal self, this sense of identity, of wanting to grow this personal self, is so strong and so deep-rooted, it's not so easy to get rid of. Some years ago, Time magazine made You the Person of the Year. intimating that we humans are more or less obsessed with ourselves. Maybe there's some truth in that. Yet what would happen if we were to let go of our ego even for a short while? A master said to the painter, "To be successful, every painter must invest hours in unremitting toil and effort. To some, it will be given to let go of the ego while they paint. When this happens, a masterpiece is born." Later, a disciple asked, "Who is a master?" And the master replied, "Anyone to whom it is given to let go of the ego, such a person's life is then a masterpiece." It's a rather lovely story. One hears about some of the great artists throughout history who have lost themselves, completely immersed themselves in the project of painting something. Lost themselves out of everyday time, and some kind of masterpiece emerges as a result. In contrast to the supremacy of the individual in today's world, David Tacey has described spirit, or we could say the sacred, as the fount of human creation and the core of the natural world. He maintains that although it may be discovered initially within ourselves through quiet introspection, or perhaps through seclusion, through being on our own, once contacted, it brings an imperative to go outside of ourselves, to serve others and to serve the world. This parallels the bodhisattva path in the Buddhist tradition, which brings us now to the sacred. Within the pages of the Viveka Chudamani, or Crest Jewel of Wisdom, is the observation, "As by mixture with water and by friction, sandalwood emits an excellent odour, removing all bad smells, so divine aspiration becomes manifest when external desire is washed away. In proportion as the mind becomes firm by devotion to Atman, it renounces all desires for external things. When all desires are completely exhausted, the realization of Atman is unobstructed." I need to take a break for a moment. I'm a little faint. So it seems that the antidote for the worldly, for the utopia complex, was described by Sri Shankaracharya thousands of years ago, being the renunciation of the desires for externals in order for the Atman to be known. It sounds simple enough in theory, but its practice is probably the ultimate challenge for the human being. The sacred also featured in ancient Greece. For example, the Greek term eudaimonia is used in Aristotelian ethics and political philosophy. Commonly translated as happiness or welfare, it is said to have implications of wholeness, wisdom, human flourishing. In Aristotle's work, eudaimonia denoted the highest human good, relating to a life lived well and nobly lived. Duties done, sacrifices made in the service of others, suffering endured courageously, virtue nurtured, compassion selflessly offered. Fast forward to the 21st century. Author Hugh Mackay writes about living a good life, not as something which is going to make you feel terrific, not as something which is going to necessarily make you rich or poor, but a life which is animated by kindness and compassion, a virtuous and even a noble life. Such a life may produce inner calm, moral confidence, and a deep sense of well-being. Can you please continue to read? Your album is across.
Such a life may produce inner calm, moral confidence, and a deep sense of well-being. His view is that if the circumstances are right and with a dollop of luck, we will also experience moments of towering satisfaction and occasional sparks of happiness. For any act to count as noble or virtuous, he asserts, we need to delete our own happiness from the list of motives for such an act. If such an act is performed for our own emotional benefit, if we are acting compassionately, virtuously or ethically, in order to feel good about ourselves, we have missed the whole point, because this amounts to exploitation of the person towards whom we have acted charitably. Here we have a contemporary Western resonance to one of the core messages in the Bhagavad Gita, in which Arjuna is exhausted by Krishna not to be concerned with the fruit of action. A number of exponents of Theosophy have expressed the sacred in ways which are not too dissimilar from this. The words sacred and sacrifice have similar origins. Dr. Besant mentioned the law of sacrifice in a little book, The Laws of the Higher Life. She described it as the life of the spirit, which consists in giving and not in taking, in pouring itself out and not in grasping, in self-surrender and not in self-appropriation. The life of inexhaustible is found, that is ever bubbling up out of the illimitable fullness of the self. Putting it quite starkly, she described the sacrificial fuel as everything that belongs to the personal lower self. Renunciation or giving up certain things is a note of the Nibriti Marga, if you like, the note of our return to the sacred. However, it is our attitude to this kind of process which makes all the difference. Rather than the occasional experience of happiness mentioned by Hugh Mackay, Dr. Besant viewed sacrifice not as pain, but as joy, not as sorrow, but as delight, even bliss to the spirit. She also described the law of sacrifice as the law of joy, as unencumbered life, in which the personal nature is surrendered to Brahman, the eternal. A profound sense of unity pervades a life which is steeped in the sacred, rather than being steeped in and hostess to all that is worldly. Perhaps, in fact, we are all hostages to the worldly to a greater or lesser extent. We all live in this world. We all need certain things around us in order to function within it. But giving up the personal in order to dedicate our lives to the sacred does not necessarily require giving away all of our possessions. Rather, it is a state of mind which is marked by reverence and discernment, which regards the sacred as having supreme importance. Divine wisdom is distinct from worldly wisdom. A mind which is dedicated to the sacred is a deeply wise mind, rooted in divinity, recall the Ashwatha tree, and yet also able to function in practical ways in the world. Two outstanding modern visionary scientists who have glimpsed the sacred are worth mentioning here. One was Albert Einstein, possibly the greatest physicist who ever lived, and who was reported to have a copy of Blavatsky's The Secret Doctrine on his desk. Significantly, he wrote, "I maintain that the cosmic religious feeling is the strongest and noblest motive for scientific research." And further he wrote, "A contemporary has said, not unjustly, that in this materialistic age of ours, the serious workers are the only profoundly religious people." The importance of religious element in human nature was recognized too by Max Planck, the German theoretical physicist and Nobel Prize winner who originated quantum theory. He wrote, I quote, "Every serious and reflective person realizes, I think, that the religious element in his nature must be recognized and cultivated if all the powers of the human soul are to act together in perfect balance and harmony." And indeed, it was not by any accident that the greatest thinkers of all ages were also deeply religious souls, even though they made no public show of their religious feeling. And further, science enhances the moral values of life because it furthers a love of truth and reverence, love of truth displaying itself in the constant endeavor to arrive at a more exact knowledge of the world of mind and matter around us, and reverence because every advance in knowledge brings us face to face with the mystery of our own being. The approach to science by both men were clearly informed by the sacred, not by the worldly. The sacred is a word we use to describe a state which in many ways a mystery, unknown, and therefore strange. Lessening our attachment to the worldly indeed has a pivotal role to play in its revelation. The Viveka Chudamani describes this using the following image. As the water in the tank covered by a collection of moss does not show itself, so the Atman, enveloped by the five sheaths, produced by its own power and beginning with the Annamaya, does not manifest itself. Upon the removal of the moss is seen the pure water, capable of allaying heat and thirst and of immediately yielding great enjoyment to man. Moss can grow so densely and richly that what is underneath is completely hidden. It is also lovely to behold. Only when it is removed, though, we can view that what has been hidden. Moss here represents the complex, multifarious aspects of human nature which cover up the pure consciousness beneath. It represents all those things which bind us to the material, to the worldly, and which appear so attractive for many lives. It represents everything which makes us feel safe in this world. It is the letting go of this apparent safety, tempered with discernment, which invites a complete change as consciousness opens up to the timelessness of the infinite, to pure consciousness. The Viveka Chudamani provides a logical sequence in order for us to proceed. The pursuit of external objects being checked, tranquility of the mind, that is manas, is produced. From the tranquility of manas arises the vision of Paramatman, the Logos. From the clear perception of Paramatman results the destruction of the bondage of conditioned existence. Restraint of the external is the way to liberation. Realize that thou art that, Brahman which alone shines, which is beyond the Logos, all-pervading, uniform, truth, consciousness, bliss, having no end, indestructible. Finally, imagination is also a very powerful tool which can help to engineer change. Can we actually visualize ourselves as vessels of that? We define ourselves in so many ways, especially through our accomplishments, our possessions, and so forth. Is it possible to let go of these definitions and simply visualize ourselves as Brahman, which alone shines? So we have ventured from the worldly to the often painful transition from the worldly to the sacred, to this sacred itself. The sense of the sacred is perhaps our ultimate sense. There is a very real interiority about it. The sense of the sacred is energized and sustained by a clear perspective on the material world, by reverence, compassion, truth, beauty, goodness, by an ability to discern what is really important, and most of all, by an unshakable sense of unity. It is fitting to finish with another verse from Longfellow's Keramos, which describes poetically the unity of humanity. The birds' words speak for themselves. Turn, turn, my will, the human race, of every tongue, of every place, Caucasian, Coptic, or Malay, all that inhabit this great earth, whatever be their rank or worth, are kindred and allied by birth and made of the same clay. Thank you.
Would you like to say something? Would you like to say something?
Friends, it is a long-standing practice in our Theosophical gathering here not to summarize the talk of the speaker so that you go with the original words. This talk could be summarized in tomorrow's daily bulletin and also in the Theosophies that will be published. On your behalf and on my behalf and on behalf of the Theosophical Society, I like to thank Sister Linda for her talk. And afterwards at 7:30, we have the ritual of the Mystic Star in the headquarters hall. Thank you.
Hello. Dr. Revati or M.A. Revindan, please go to dais.